presenting my work on my thesis that I did with Dr. Brandon Williams. I'm looking at developing coral and algae as a means for studying environmental change in the Arctic. So before I dive in, I just want to thank everyone who made this work possible, including my parents, who are also here today. All right. So before I jump in, I did want to just give a little bit more background about me and what I'm interested in. So I am majoring in chemistry, but I'm really most interested in chemistry as a tool to study environmental change. So how we can use chemistry to figure out things about how humans are affecting the oceans and the climate. And so I've been really lucky to be able to do a lot of different research experiences all relating to this question. So I started working in Professor Williams' lab during my first year here at Scripps. This is a picture of me and my lab partner this summer after our first year looking at nitrogen in coral. Then the next summer I looked at rivers in Texas here, and then the year after I was in Panama, again looking at the questions of environmental science and human change on the environment. This is me snorkeling in Panama. And then just before starting my thesis, I worked with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration looking at carbon now in salt marshes. So a lot of different experiences that all relate to this question of chemistry in the natural world. So moving forward to my senior thesis, in the sciences, really the best way to get really high quality publishable data tends to be to work on projects that are already being pursued by faculty here. So I chose to work, to take a little slice of work that Professor Williams is looking at and how we can use natural archives to study conditions in the Arctic. So you've probably heard a lot about climate change and about the ice caps melting. So we know that climate change is occurring. We know that changes are happening in the Arctic. We know that Arctic sea ice is melting. We know that temperatures are rising. But we don't have a lot of context for these changes. We don't know what has been happening in the Arctic even 100 years ago or 500 years ago. And that makes it really hard to contextualize these recent changes. We don't know how exactly these changes are going to move forward, what the impacts of these changes will be. And a big part of why we don't know that information is that we just don't have very good records for the region. We only have satellite data showing us about sea ice and sea surface temperature in the Arctic going back to the 70s. And before that, all of the information we have is just based on ships of opportunity measuring the water temperature. So this map here shows the number of sea surface temperature observations just for 1930, so not even a century ago. The dark blue is everywhere where not a single measurement has been taken. So you can see in this highlighted box that I'm interested in, we really just have no idea what was happening for a really large part of the Arctic with regards to sea surface temperature. Luckily for us, we can use natural proxies or indirect means of measuring to study things like the climate of the Arctic. So the way that proxy works is if we want to know about historic rainfall here in Claremont, we could go out and chop down a tree and then look at the tree rings of the tree stump left over. So years where it rained a lot, the tree will be happier, growing better, they'll be thicker tree rings. And during drought years, the tree rings will be thinner. So that's great, and it works great, but there's not a lot of trees in the Arctic. Instead, I use coral and algae as my natural proxy. So this algae is not, you know, what you would find in a lake. It's coral and algae, which means that it's a plant, but it looks a lot like a rock. Here you can see it growing on the bottom of the ocean floor in the Arctic. It grows around 50 feet deep, and this is a specimen in the lab dried. So it doesn't really look like algae you've probably seen before. But it's a really helpful proxy because it can live for hundreds of years. It grows in these really high altitude conditions where not a lot can grow. And also, like a tree, it has distinct growth bands. So here you can see I've sectioned and polished a specimen. And you can see that they are bands for the different years of growth. So, like with the tree example, I can go back, measure the skeleton material for each year of growth, and then use that material to tell us things about the water at the time where it was grown. So, instead of looking at the width of the growth bands in the tree, I'm looking at some of the chemistry of the skeleton material. Specifically, I'm looking at the oxygen ratio, oxygen isotopic ratios, and the ratio of magnesium to calcium in the skeleton. Both of these things might sound a little boring, but they're really exciting because they can tell us things about the water that it was grown in. Both of these factors are correlated to temperature. So when the water is warmer, both of these are higher. And then oxygen isotopes specifically also correlate to salinity. Salinity is a little less obvious why you care, but salinity in the Arctic is tied to sea ice. So when sea ice melts, the salinity goes down. So theoretically, by testing both of these in my coral and algae, we can go back and figure out what historic temperature and ice and salinity conditions have been for my sample set. So, getting into my methods, before I go much further, I want to clarify, I'm not actually applying this as a proxy. I'm not trying to figure out what was happening 500 years ago. Instead, I'm in the proxy calibration phase. So I'm testing magnesium, calcium, oxygen for a really short, fairly short time period, ended up being 22 years, for which we have pretty good observational data, and then comparing it to see if it does in fact work as a proxy. So then I could go back, get more algae specimens, and actually be able to use it as a proxy. So it's still a pretty early step. So I'm working with specimens that Professor Williams got a couple years ago from the Canadian Arctic that I had in the lab. So I sectioned them, polished them, took the images as you can see, and then I collected material from them using a micro mill drill, like you can see here. So on the computer screen, I can trace out where exactly I want the drill to go, and then I collect material from each growth band. So just get tiny, tiny bits of algae dust, basically. Then I can dissolve this algae dust in acid and then analyze the magnesium-calcium ratios using an inductively coupled plasma optical emission spectrometer. So that's for magnesium-calcium. I also tested the oxygen isotopes of this algae powder at UC Irvine on a mass spec. So that was also a cool opportunity to see it in different big school lab environment. So here's a quick glance at my results. So I have the magnesium-calcium ratios that I found plotted in the blue, and oxygen is in the green. So just looking at this data, it probably doesn't look like a whole lot, but in science, this is actually statistically significant. So these lines are correlated. You can see they're going up together, and then they went down together, even though there is some other noise going on. So this is really exciting, because this is what we would expect. Temperature is a driver for both magnesium, calcium, and oxygen. So we would expect them to follow similar trends if that is in fact true. What's interesting is that when I compared both of these chronologies to sea surface temperature data that we have for the area, they did not correlate. So I did not find that it was recording temperature just for this time period. So I'm thinking about what this means. I said at the beginning that the reason why we need proxies is because we don't have really great observational data for the region. That's true, but it also makes it really hard to develop proxies because we need observational data to do that. So there isn't a trend with temperature. Well, the temperature data that we have for this area is over a really wide area. It's also just for the surface, whereas my algae, if you remember, were collected from depth, around 50 feet deep. And so I hypothesized that it's probably due to something like stratification, so where there's colder water down below and warmer water at the surface. So that means that whatever temperature signal the algae is capturing might not be captured in the observational data that we have. So moving forward, I think that we can get around some of those issues by testing over a longer period of time and possibly looking at the ratios in multiple specimens. So I'm actually going to be continuing this work for the next couple months and doing exactly that, and then also switching to higher resolution means of sampling. So I look forward to talking more if anyone has questions.